أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
كل نفس ذائقة الموت وإنما توفون أجوركم يوم القيامة فمن زحزح عن النار وأدخل الجنة فقد فاز وما الحياة الدنيا إلا متاع الغرور.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for each and every blessing that He has given us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins and to conceal our faults from the eyes of men and on the day of judgment. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to exalt our ranks and to make our scales heavy and to cause us to enter Jannah without any hisab and adab and to bypass Jahannam. We ask Allah azza wa jal for the fruits of Iman in this world and the fruits of Iman in the next world. Alhamdulillah thumma alhamdulillah. I am thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have covered so many topics, and now today we begin yet another series. And even though we are beginning another series, in fact this is a continuation of the entire series that I've been doing for almost a year and a half now, alhamdulillah thumma alhamdulillah. And that series begins with the signs of the day of judgment, and we covered the major and the minor signs. We went over all that has been narrated in the Quran and the Sunnah about the ashrat as-sa'ah. And then we finished that one. And then I started a new series on the Barzakh. And we went over in quite a lot of detail that interlude between this world and the next world. And what do we know about that interlude of the Barzakh? And then when we finished that series, I then started a very detailed series about what we know about Qiyamah itself, about the Day of Judgment itself. And alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, I finished that series. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jal for acceptance, and I ask forgiveness for any mistakes that might have been made. But we are not done yet. We still need to move on from that series, because the Day of Judgment is but the intermediate stage between the actual final stage. And the actual final stage is, of course, either the punishment of Allah, we seek Allah's refuge from that, which is Jahannam, or the reward of Allah, which is inshallah our destination, and that is Jannah. And so we are now going to begin the final part of that series, the entire series. And of course, today is the first day, or the first of that separate series. And we will be covering what we know about heaven and hell. And of course, belief in heaven and hell, belief in Jannah and Jahannam, is one of the core fundamental beliefs of this religion. And you will hardly find a page of the Quran except that it mentions the belief. Now, of course, this goes back to belief in the Day of Judgment, because again, what is the point of the Day of Judgment? What is the concept? Yani, what is the gharad? What is the goal of the Day of Judgment? The goal of the Day of Judgment is to then decide the fate. So wherever and however Allah proves the Day of Judgment, that whenever Qiyamah is mentioned, automatically it is implied that we're going to believe in heaven and hell. Even though, of course, the Quran mentions many, many hundreds of verses about actual Jannah and Jahannam, but the concept of the afterlife, of the Akhirah, it is something that is very explicit. In fact, in the famous hadith of Jibreel, the famous hadith of Jibreel that lists the six arkan of Iman. So there are multiple versions of this hadith. It's not just one version. And in some versions, for example, in the version found in the Sahih of Ibn Hibban. So Ibn Hibban also wrote a book called Sahih. So Bukhari wrote a book called Sahih, Muslim wrote a book called Sahih. And then there was two other people, Ibn Hibban and Ibn Khuzaymah. Four people, they attempted in Islamic history to write a book of Sahih in early Islam. And so Ibn Hibban is one of them. And in the version of Ibn Hibban, the hadith of Jibreel mentions that you believe in the Ba'ath, وَتُؤْمِنَ بِالْجَنَّةِ وَالنَّارِ وَالْمِيزَانِ. So in the hadith of Jibreel, it lists that you're going to believe in the Day of Judgment, and you are going to believe in heaven and in hell and in the Mizan. So it is very explicit, therefore, that belief in heaven and hell is a fundamental belief of Islam. Anybody who denies the existence of heaven and hell, anybody who denies that there's a reality eternity of heaven and hell has denied the explicit testimony of the Quran, and that is why there is no interpretation of Islam, there is no acceptable interpretation of Islam that would reject this core fundamental belief. It can be said that anybody who does not believe in an afterlife has in fact rejected the Quran and has rejected the Lord of the Quran and rejected the messengership of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You cannot be Muslim without believing in Jannah and Jahannam. It is that simple. Now, inshallah ta'ala, today we're going to begin the topic. We're not going to go into a lot of detail. And by the way, we're going to begin with the topic of Jahannam and then move on to Jannah. The reason being that, in fact, the Quran, whenever it talks about Jannah and Jahannam, sometimes it mentions Jannah first, and sometimes it mentions Jahannam first. But it can be said that generally speaking, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the punishment. Like generally, if you look at overall the Quran, that generally speaking, Allah mentions the punishment and then He mentions the reward. For example, look at the last verses of Surah Az-Zumur. Look at, for example, Surah Ar-Rahman as well, and many other verses as well that generally speaking, again, there are many exceptions. It's not even an overall rule, because there are plenty of verses in the Quran, plenty of passages where Allah mentions Jannah first and then mentions Jahannam. But overall, I would say that the majority of instances is first Jahannam and then Jannah. And the reason being is that we want to end on an optimistic note, that overall Allah's Rahmah and Allah's mercy is encompassing of all, and that Allah Azza wa Jal is Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, and therefore we should end on that positive note. We should want to aspire to be forgiven by Allah and have the hope of Allah's forgiveness. And therefore, in this series of lectures, from next lecture, today is going to be the setup of the whole series. From the next lecture, inshallah ta'ala, we'll begin with some of the details of Jahannam and then move on to some of the details of Jannah, inshallah ta'ala. Now, the reality of Jannah and Jahannam is of course something that is explicitly mentioned in the Quran and Sunnah in multiple verses. And in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Jannah and Jahannam even before He created Adam alayhi salam. And so before even there was man, there was Jannah and Jahannam. And of course we know this from many, many verses. Of them is, of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam and Hawa and then said to them, enter Jannah, right? So therefore there is already Jannah when He created Adam and Hawa, and He's telling them, go and enter Jannah. And in the famous hadith in Sahih Muslim, Abu Huraira reports that the Prophet sallallahu الله عليه وسلم said, لما خلق الله الجنة والنار أرسل جبرائيل إلى الجنة. When Allah created heaven and hell, He sent Jibra'il to Jannah, and He said to Jibra'il, go look at Jibra'il, go look at Jannah and see what I have prepared for the people of Jannah. And so Jibreel went to Jannah and saw all that Allah had prepared for the people of Jannah. When he came back, he said to Allah, وَعِزَّتِكَ, I swear by your honor, O Allah, that no creation can hear about what is in here except that they're going to enter it. How can anybody not enter? All of these blessings and delights, how can you possibly not want to be in Jannah? Everybody will enter Jannah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Jibreel that I have now surrounded Jannah with the difficulties that people need to do to get into Jannah, right? So, فَحُفَّتْ بِالْمَكَارِهِ. Makarih means that which is difficult. Makruh. Makarih means that which is an obstacle. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put around Jannah, metaphorically meaning how Allah does it, we're not going to ask how, in a way that He knows, in a way that Jibreel understands. Allah showed Jibreel the struggles that people have to do to get into Jannah. And so Jibreel then went back and looked at the makarih, or the struggles outside of Jannah. And then Jibreel said, that I swear by your honor, O Allah, I am actually worried that now nobody might be able to get in. Nobody might be able to get in once they see the struggles of what it requires to get into Jannah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel to the fire of hell. And He said to Jibreel, go and look at what I have prepared for the people of hell. And so Jibreel looked, and then he came back and he said, that, and he saw the fire of hell enveloping itself and eating itself. It was so vicious, it was so vile and evil, that it was as if hell was in itself swallowing and wallowing in its own punishment. So Jibreel saw this, and he then came back and he said, I swear by your honor, O Allah, that no one can possibly hear about this accept that they're going to be saved. They're never going to do anything to get into this place. I mean, it's understood when they know what is this place, no one can possibly enter it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala surrounded the fire of hell with the lusts and desires and temptations, with the shahawat. And that is the passage to go into Jahannam. And then he sent Jibreel and said, look at what is around Jahannam. And so Jibreel then came back and said that, I swear by your honor, O Allah, I am now worried that nobody will be safe from Jahannam. Now that you've shown us the delectable delights that lead to Jahannam, the pleasures of the body, the shahawat that lead to Jahannam, now that I've seen all of this, I am worried that everybody's going to get involved with those pleasures and then they're going to enter into Jahannam. We seek Allah's refuge. So this shows us a very important point. This hadith is in Sahih Muslim and in the Sunan of Abu Dawud and in Tirmidhi, and it is an authentic hadith. Now this hadith demonstrates for us a number of things. First and foremost, that Allah has already created heaven and hell. These are realities. They are not going to be created in the future. They are existent right now. Secondly, that the realities of Jannah and Jahannam are self-evident even to the angels, who will not be enjoying Jannah or being punished in Jahannam. The angels are separate from this realm in the sense that the angels don't have pleasures. The angels are not beings that experience pain or pleasure. They are a different creation from Allah, of Allah Azza wa Jal. And yet, even that species, when they have seen Jannah, they desire Jannah. Imagine that. And even that species, when they saw the Jahannam, they were frightful of Jahannam and they said nobody can possibly end up in Jahannam. And this shows us what amazing reality must this be, that even a creation that doesn't desire actually had a desire. And even the creation that does not fear Jahannam was actually fearful of it. And the same goes as well when Jibreel saw the pleasures around Jannah and the pleasures around Jahannam and the difficulties around Jannah, that even Jibreel understood how difficult it is, the entrance to Jannah, and how easy it is, the path to enter Jahannam. And so all of this is great wisdom and food for thought. And of course, another reality about Jannah and Jahannam is that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he saw Jannah and Jahannam with his own eyes. Anybody who believes in Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, anybody who believes that Allah inspired this man to teach and preach to us, must also believe that Jannah and Jahannam is existent, because he told us he saw it with his own eyes. And it wasn't just one time, multiple times he has seen Jannah and Jahannam. Of course, there are certain dreams that he tells us about Jannah and Jahannam, but he has also seen it in Isra and Mi'raj, and he has seen it in wakeful state as well. And there are many evidences of this nature. As for Isra and Mi'raj, you can listen to the Seerah lectures that I've given, any book of Seerah, and it will go into detail that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw aspects of Jannah, and he heard the footsteps of Bilal, and he saw the palace of Umar ibn Khattab, and so many things that he saw. And he also saw the punishments meted out either in the Barzakh or pre-Jahannam or Jahannam itself. He saw all of this in the journey of Isra wal Mi'raj. And also when his son Ibrahim passed away and the eclipse took place, our Prophet sallallahu Allahu alayhi wa sallam stood in a long, long salah. This is called the salah of the khusuf, or the salah of the eclipse prayer. And it is a prayer that is done. It is the sunnah. Unfortunately, so many times we do not follow this. But whenever there is a solar or a lunar eclipse, we should be standing in salah. And it is a long, long salah. And our Prophet stood for the entire duration of the eclipse. And it is a special salah. It has its own rulings. There's two ruku'as in every sajda, by the way. In every one rak'ah, there's two ruku'as. And this is an interesting point of Salat al-Khusuf. So our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam stood in Salat al-Khusuf, and when he finished the salah and he turned to face the people, he gave them a lecture, a maw'idah, that affected them, that moved them. And one phrase in that, as reported in Sahih Muslim and other books of hadith, رَأَيْتُ فِي مَقَامِ هَذَا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ وَعِدْتُمْ. I have seen everything as I was standing in salah. All that I promised you, I saw it. حَتَّى لَقَدْ رَأَيْتُنِي أُرِيدُ أَنْ أَخُذَ قِطَفَ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ. That even I saw that, I saw Jannah itself. And I could see a bunch of grapes in Jannah. And the Prophet ﷺ was standing in Salah, they saw him move forward in Salah. And then they saw him move back in Salah. So long narration that during the Salat al-Khusuf, he moved a step forward. And then he moved back to his place. And then he moved backwards. And then he moved back to his place. And then he's explaining what happened. And he said, I saw everything that you have been promised. So much so that I saw some of the fruits of Jannah, some of the grapes of Jannah. And I went forward to want to pluck some of those dates. And then he decided not to do that. Then he said, if I had plucked from those dates and put them on this earth, you would have eaten from it until the day of judgment. It would never have finished. One bunch of grapes would have sufficed whoever ate from it until the day of judgment. But of course, Allah's hikmah is that is from ilm al-ghayb, we will not see it. And then he said, وَلَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ جَهَنَّمُ And I saw the fire of hell. And I saw it engulfing itself. And that is when you saw me move backward from the heat of the fire of hell. I moved backward. Now this hadith demonstrates as well that Jannah and Jahannam are realities that our Prophet ﷺ saw with his own eyes. They are currently in existence. So of course, as I said, no Muslim denies this. None of the interpretations or groups of Islam that believe in the Quran and believe in the Prophet ﷺ as a prophet and are considered to be Muslims deny heaven and hell. Now before I jump into the details, that's going to be from next week inshallah ta'ala, or next lesson. As you know, I always contextualize, I always historicize, I always want to look at it from a broader perspective. And what I'd like to do today for the rest of our 25-30 minutes, inshallah ta'ala, is actually to educate ourselves as Muslims about the world views of other faiths and other civilizations so that we can better appreciate our own. Now, some people, they question and they wonder and they say, why would you teach us what other faith traditions say? Let us stick only with our own faith tradition. And we say that in fact there is much benefit, and that's why the Quran explicitly mentions the faiths of other people. The Quran teaches us that there's something called the Trinity. The Quran teaches us that there's something called idolatry. And therefore this notion of we shouldn't hear anything about other faiths and whatnot, it goes back to what is your intention of wanting to learn and study. Allah says in the Quran, that وَكَذَلِكَ نُفَصِّلُ الْآيَاتِ وَلِتَسْتَبِينَ سَبِيلُ الْمُجْرِمِينَ This is how we clarify the clear signs so that the path of the wicked people can be made clear. The path of the evil people can be made clear. Allah says, I want to make clear to you. I want to clarify to you the path of the evil people. Why? Because as one of the poets of the past said, I learnt evil, not so that I can follow evil, but to avoid it. Because the one who doesn't separate truth from evil, the one who doesn't know truth from evil, will then fall into evil. And the famous companion, Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman, radiallahu ta'ala an, hadith is in Sahih Muslim, he said that, كَانَ النَّاسُ يَسْأَلُونَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَنِ الْخَيْرِ وَكُنْتُ أَسْأَلُهُ عَنِ الشَّرِّ مَخَافَةَ أَنْ يُدْرِكَنِي The people would ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم about good things, but I would concentrate on asking about the negatives, about the bad things. Why? Not because he loved it, because I was worried those things might happen to me. I was worried that I might fall into something bad, so I would ask him about the negative things. And somebody asked Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu an, that what will be the destruction of Islam? How will Islam be harmed or destroyed? He said, when a generation comes that wasn't raised in Jahiliyyah or doesn't know Jahiliyyah. When a new generation comes, they don't know Jahiliyyah. This is a very profound statement from Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu an. Why? Because the people of Jahiliyyah, the Muslims who converted, they knew the evils pre-Islam, and they could appreciate the goods of Islam. They could appreciate what it means to believe in La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, to have the Quran, to have the Sharia. But there's going to come generations that don't appreciate it. They take it for granted. So Umar al-Khattab said, when people don't know what is Jahiliyyah, when they are raised having no understanding, they're living in complete blissful ignorance about what is the reality of not having faith, of not having iman, they're not going to appreciate it. Therefore, it is actually very useful for us to know what other faiths say so that we can then appreciate and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and increase our iman in what we ourselves believe. And of course, this is a brief introduction. Obviously, this is a speciality that people can spend many, many years and decades specializing in. What is interesting to note when it comes to beliefs in the afterlife life with regards to all faith traditions is that pretty much it is a universal belief in all faith traditions that somehow life is going to go on after death. None of the major established world religions says that life ends at the time of death. That is not what is in the established religion. Yes, there were people in the past, and there might also be today. Of course, there are the agnostics and the atheists that say the same thing. That, and even they, by the way, even amongst them, there are philosophies that consciousness somehow lives on or whatnot. But, you know, by and large, the faith traditions of the world, the established religions of the world, they all have mechanisms, or they all have beliefs that indicate that, or that have this notion that life is somehow going to continue after death in this world. And generally speaking, again, this is a very introductory lecture. Generally speaking, the religions of the world are divided into two broad categories, the Abrahamic religions and the Dharmic religions. This is the general categorization of religions. Of course, the Abrahamic religions, generally speaking, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, some have added on to that, tacked on to that Zoroastrianism, and some have said Mandaeanism. But basically, it's the three major religions of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And the Abrahamic religions, all of them, they are very clear in their original scriptures that there is a belief in the hereafter, that there is a concept of heaven and hell. And this is the standard mainstream belief of Jews, Christians, and Muslims, that there shall be an actual resurrection. There is an actual heaven where the souls will be in eternal bliss. There's an actual hell where there will be an everlasting punishment. And especially in Christianity and Islam, out of the three, especially in Christianity and Islam, this is still the default and the main belief amongst all of the, call them the Orthodox or the traditionalists, or the bulk of even today Protestants and Catholics and Orthodox and mainstream Christian traditions. Of course, there are fringe movements, you know, like the Seventh-day Adventists and other. These have their own interpretations, but by and large, mainstream Christianity, and of course, pretty much all of the groups of Islam, they believe in an actual heaven and hell. Now, the Jewish faith tradition is a little bit more complicated. The Quran tells us that the Jews believed in an afterlife, and they definitely did when the Quran came down. As Allah says in the Quran, وَقَالُوا لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَةً. They said, even if we go to hell, we're only going to go for a little bit of while, and then we're going to move on to Jannah. And Allah says in the Quran that the Yahud and Nasara said that none shall enter Jannah except if they are Yahud and Nasara, right? لَن يَلْخُنْ جَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا تِلْكَ أَمَانِيُّهُمْ. That's their claim. But here Allah is saying they believed in something called a Jannah. And that is very clear. They definitely did. In early Judaic faith traditions, there's no question that mainstream Judaism believed in a resurrection and in an afterlife. However, even in early Judaism, there was a sect known as the Sadducees, and this is mentioned in the Old Testament, and the New Testament mentions the Sadducees, that the Sadducees, an ancient sect, they actually denied the day of judgment. Nonetheless, mainstream Judaism believed that there's going to be heaven and hell, so much so that Maimonides, Musa ibn Maimun, or Moses Maimonides, who is considered to be the great rabbi, he's called Rambam, or the great rabbi, the main theologian and the main figurehead of Judaism. And of course, he's an interesting figure because he was born and raised in Muslim Andalusia, and he was influenced by Muslim aqidah and Muslim culture. He studied fiqh and whatnot, and he wrote even in Arabic and in Crypto-Arabic and in Judeo-Arabic, and he lived in Muslim lands, and he flourished in Muslim lands, and he died in Muslim lands. And he was personal physician, because he was a doctor as well, of a number of Muslim sultans. So Moses Maimonides is the main codifier of Jewish law and theology. And Moses Maimonides, he wrote a little treatise called the 13, basically, articles of faith, the 13 articles of Iman. And for the advanced students here, it's very similar to the theology of Ibn Rushd as well. So Ibn Rushd then, in terms of sifat and whatnot. Anyway, that's a whole different point. So what was I saying? Musa ibn Maimun, he wrote this 13 articles of faith. And in that, he explicitly says that the Jewish people, we believe that there will take place a revival of the dead at a time that will please the Creator, that the dead are going to come back to life at a time that will please thee, whatever Allah knows is going to happen. So Moses Maimonides codified this as a part of the doctrines of what Jews are supposed to believe. And that is why to this day, if you look up any Orthodox Jewish website, they will quote Moses Maimonides and they'll say, this is what the theology is. But then they're going to say, but how do we interpret this? What does it actually mean? And so Orthodox Judaism has begun to basically allow for interpretations that deny a reality of heaven and hell. And they do not make it now, they do not consider what Moses and Maimonides wrote to be like the unambiguous verdict. They simply say, well, it has multiple interpretations. As for conservative Judaism and Reform Judaism and Reconstructionist Judaism, they have either outright rejected, or they have said that it is not an article of faith and you don't have to believe in an afterlife. And so it is interesting to note, and even amongst the Orthodox, that generally speaking, they don't emphasize this point that much. It's not something that is a mainstream or something that is a cardinal belief. If you ask, they might say, well, there might be an afterlife or not, or heaven and hell, or there's just a heightened state of consciousness. A number of them, if you read their beliefs, this is my interpretation, they seem closer to the Buddhist concept of nirvana than an actual heaven in this regard. Now, in any case, the point is that generally speaking, the modern practitioners of the Jewish faith, generally speaking, do not have the same notions of heaven and hell that mainstream Christians do and mainstream Muslims do. So this is Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. By the way, I said Zoroastrianism and others. So Zoroastrianism is, of course, one of the most ancient religions. And it is very likely, it's just a theory of mine, it is very likely that this religion does go back to an actual prophet of Allah, but it was corrupted over time from it. Allah knows best. The reason we say this is because there are certain key beliefs that are very prophetic in nature. Nonetheless, we do not know, and we leave that knowledge to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Zoroastrianism does believe that those that are righteous and they live according to their laws, that they shall live an eternal life of light and bliss. Because one of the key points of the Zoroastrian religion is that their God is the God of light, Ahura Mazda, and the evil is darkness, Ahriman. And so they said that the righteous shall live in bliss, in light with Ahura Mazda. And the wicked are condemned to eternal darkness. They're condemned to eternal darkness, which is basically their version of hell. Now, of course, all of these beliefs, the Abrahamic beliefs, all of them, they say that the soul is one soul, and it is sent into this world, and then it shall move on to the next world. None of the Abrahamic faiths believe in reincarnation of the same soul. They don't believe in it. That's what makes them set apart. The one soul comes to earth, it lives, and then it moves on to the next realm or afterlife. And the goal of this world is to earn the pleasure of the Creator, so that when you make it to the next realm, you shall be in the place of bliss and not in the place of punishment. Okay, this is the reality of the Abrahamic traditions. And by the way, it's not just the Abrahamic traditions, some of the ancient religions that are no longer existent, it is also clear that they believed in concepts of heaven and hell as well. For example, the Greeks and the Romans, it is very clear that they believed in some type of afterlife. There's bliss and there's, of course, hell. Hell, Hades and whatnot is very clear as well. Even the Norse, the Norse religion mythology, the Nordic religions, they also believe, you know, the Vikings, they follow the Nordic religion, the ancient religion of Europe. And they clearly believe as well in a notion of heaven. They called it Valhalla, in which they're going to be reunited with the god Odin and be in eternal bliss. And they also have a notion of punishment. They called it Nilfhel. And of course, the English word hell is related to the Norse word as well, Nilfhel, which is basically the eternal punishment will be taking place there. And of course, the ancient Egyptians. Anyway, by the way, the Egyptians, again, all of these are tangents. One of the reasons why they would embalm the dead and put them in their, you know, mummified states was that they believed that that would help the soul in its journey to the afterlife. So they had this notion of their own version of barzakh, and then their own version of, you know, crossing over some type of bridge or river, and then the afterlife after this. And for all of us, those that don't believe in God, the atheists, they say, look at you people, you are believing in the same types of myths that are found across the global traditions. And of course, I've responded to this multiple times, that we can flip it around 180 and say the very fact that these notions exist in so many disparate civilizations, the very fact that the ancient Vikings believed in something of this nature, so did the Egyptians, you know, so did the ancient Greeks and Romans, so do the Abrahamic religions, rather than saying that, you know, this is the product of a human being, we can flip it around and say, if there were no divine revelation, where would these things come from? Why would, according to them, a species that doesn't have a higher creator and purpose, why would everybody invent a similar notion? How is that happening? We will flip it around and we will say, actually, all of these notions, even to the civilizations that don't know their own prophet, the notion is trickling down from the prophets, because we believe that prophets were sent to all civilizations and some of their teachings would have remained. And so we don't know who was sent to ancient Europe and the Viking civilization. We don't know what remnants were left, but we do believe that they must have had some prophet in the ancient era, you know, before the coming of the Prophet ﷺ. Somebody would have come to those civilizations and some of that teaching would have remained. And of those teachings that remained, even if so many other things were lost, was this notion of an afterlife and a heaven and a hell. So this is overall the Abrahamic religions and also the ancient religions of old. Now, in contrast to this, of course, the one tradition that is in contrast to this is, of course, ancient Hinduism. And from Hinduism, of course, you had the sprouting forth of Buddhism and Jainism, and of course, Sikhism as well. So in reality, it is one faith tradition overall, the philosophy. If you know your history, then of course, Siddhartha Buddha, of course, was a Hindu, and then he broke away and he founded his own understanding. But in reality, the paradigm is a Hindu paradigm. And so the dharmic religions, even though there are four or five in number, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and to a lesser degree, Sikhism, but in reality, they have a similar philosophy because they all go back to the same belief. And that, of course, ancient Hinduism. And they are separate completely from the rest of the world traditions when it comes to the belief of the afterlife. And of course, for them, the dharmic religions, life is not a one that you come and you live your life and then there's going to be an afterlife. No, for them, life is cyclical. Life is circular. That once you finish one life in this world, you will then come back again. You'll be resurrected again. And it's a continuous loop. And the goal of life is to break free from that loop. The goal of life is that you no longer are a part of that circle, that you keep on coming back and forth. They don't want that. They want to break away. And of course, in Hinduism, it's called moksha. Moksha in Buddhism is called nirvana. And so there's different ways of achieving that. There's the eight paths of, you know, fulfillment and breaking away from the cycle. The point being that these faith traditions do not believe in an actual heaven and hell the way that we do. And they have a completely different understanding. And they believe that depending on how you lived your life, the next life you will be resurrected in accordance with how good you were, and you slowly continue to rise. And when you rise in the highest category of their caste system, you now have the option, if you live according to their principles, that you will then break away and then achieve oneness, you know, that is the nirvana or whatnot, or mokshi with they call it atman or whatnot, but the point is, that's not the point of today's lecture, but they break away from the cycle of life and they will achieve eternal bliss in their own way. Now, one can say there's an element of Jannah in there, in that they still say eternal bliss and being one with whatever it is. Still, it is not our notion of heaven and hell. It's not our notion of how we believe it. But still, there is an element of, hey, if you live your life righteously and you continue to do so, eventually you shall attain eternal bliss. And in that regard, it is true to say every single faith tradition in the world has that notion, that if you live a good life, now who defines good? Your religion, however your religion defines good. If you live a good life, then you shall eventually live a blissful, however the existence might be. The difference is that the Abrahamic traditions, they say that you yourself will understand your bliss and you will be in Jannah, whereas the other traditions don't have that notion, and you might just become one with the whole and your consciousness will be subsumed by other consciousnesses. But still, there is that notion of eternal bliss. Jayid. Okay, that's all of the current faith traditions. As for the Arabs before the coming of Islam, what did they believe? It is difficult to reconstruct their beliefs fully because as with such primitive paganism, because it was primitive paganism, they don't have a holy book, right? They don't have a codified faith tradition. Rather, the Arabs of Islam were very, they had different notions of morality, of afterlife, and the Quran is consistently criticizing them for one notion, and that is their rejection of a bodily resurrection. That is undeniable. None of the Arabs believed in a bodily resurrection, and they mocked a bodily resurrection. Now, did they believe in a consciousness remaining in the next life? It appears that, generally speaking, the Arabs of Hijaz did not do so. The Quran is addressing them primarily, and there is no notion of a soul existing onwards. Now, there are some there's some pre-Islamic poetry that might seem to suggest that some tribes did believe in some type of consciousness maintaining onwards. That could be the case. Still, it is not the predominant belief of the Arabs coming to Islam. Allah says in the Quran, وَقَالُوا إِنْ هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا وَمَا يُهْلِكُنَا إِلَّا الدَّهَرُ. They said, it's only one life that we live. We live and we die. نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا. We're going to die, we're going to live, and nothing is going to destroy us other than time. By time here, adhar here, they don't mean the clock time, they mean like destiny. They mean just that when the Quran and Sunnah uses the word dahr, it is a type of destiny, like this is our destiny. We're going to live and we're going to die, and that is it. Nothing is going to bring us back again. And so this is the predominant, the mainstream belief of pre-Islamic Arabs, that they denied there's going to be an actual resurrection. They denied a qiyamah. They made fun of the fact that our bodies can be resurrected. And this is, of course, a constant theme. Almost every single page of the Quran criticizes the Arabs for this belief and proves that there's going to be a day of judgment, and of course, by implication, a heaven and a hell. Now, again, I went over when I talked about the day of judgment, the very first lecture, I went over in a lot of detail some of the arguments that the Quran uses to prove the day of judgment and some of the wisdoms of the day of judgment. I refer you to that lecture nonetheless, just in case some of you have, and also it's been a long time. I'm going to go over very quickly because we are beginning a new series about heaven and hell, and some of the wisdoms of the belief in the day of judgment, we can extrapolate them, we can read in a little bit more to talk about the wisdoms and the beliefs. Why is there a heaven and a hell? And of course, the Quran and Sunnah is very explicit about this belief. And Allah mentions that the one who created them the first time can recreate them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds mankind that the one who creates mankind can recreate mankind. That He is the one who created the creation and He can redo it all over again. And Allah says in the Quran, surely the one who created this creation is capable of creating something similar to it. And Allah Azza wa Jalla reminds us that the world around us shows us that the dead can come back to life, in the sense of when you look at soil that is not fertile, when you look at even the power of the nature around you, when Allah mentions that, look at the fire that gets from the tree that you obtain from. Where does it come from, that power? Who created all of this? Allah tells us to look at the entire creation. And so the one who created the creation is indeed all powerful to create other creations like heaven and hell. But what is particularly interesting is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses as well the rational argument of proving heaven and hell. It's not just He uses His power. It's not just He says, look at how powerful I am, I can do this. It's not just He says, I know what I'm telling you, believe in me, which is also in the Quran, that Allah says, this is the truth, innahu lahaq. That's also there. And Allah uses His power. But Allah also uses a rational argument to appeal to the common sense of every human being that we should believe in an afterlife and in heaven and hell. Allah says in the Quran, أَفَنَجْعَلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ كَالْمُجْرِمِينَ مَا لَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ. Do you think that the believers and the criminals should be the same? What is the matter with you? How are you judging? This is a very powerful verse. If you negate heaven and hell, if you say there's no such thing as heaven and hell, well then, you know, somebody who lived their whole life being kind and generous and feeding the poor and taking care of relatives and then somebody who was like a mass murderer, a genocidal dictator, a Hitler or a Fir'aun, you're going to say that khalas, they lived, they died, and that's it? That's not fair. How is that fair? And Allah is asking a rhetorical question. أَفَنَجْعَلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ كَالْمُجْرِمِينَ مَا لَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ And Allah says in the Quran, أَمَّنْ هُوَ قَانِتٌ آنَاءَ اللَّيْلِ That do you think that we're going to make those who believe and do good? Sorry, another verse. أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ كَالْمُفْسِدِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الْمُتَّقِينَ كَالْفُجَّارِ Do you think that we're going to equate those who believe and do good deeds to those who do evil in the earth? Do you think that the righteous and the wicked are the same? And again, it's a rhetorical question. Those who deny Judgment Day, where is justice? You cannot believe in God except that you must affirm a day of judgment and a heaven and hell. And if you deny God, well, then you're even more foolish, because where did we come from and what explains life, etc., etc. So this is a very simple, powerful logic that helps us explain and rationalize why is there heaven and hell. And somebody can say that, well, what does it impact us if we believe in heaven and hell? What is the benefits of this? And we say, subhanAllah, where does one begin? First and foremost, it provides us a moral compass, a sense of self-discipline that is impossible to achieve otherwise. We now desire the rewards of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we're fearful of His punishment. And this brings about a sense of morality, a sense of honesty, a sense of acting in a dignified manner, not taking advantage of opportunity, being conscious that I have to answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It helps us live better and more ethical lives in our private lives when nobody is watching. We know we have to reckon in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, heaven and hell, belief in heaven and hell, it motivates us to accomplish something in our lives rather than living our lives without any purpose, just meaninglessness. And you know, imagine if, as atheists do, that there's no afterlife, there's no qiyamah. In fact, they have to invent purposes for their lives. Their lives are meaningless. It means nothing. What is the purpose of your life if you don't believe in a higher power? You don't believe in a God. You don't believe in a heaven and hell. You don't believe in an eternal life. Well then, why? What is there to motivate you to wake up? And that is one of the reasons why there is no denying that faith brings about a sense of serenity and optimism, and a lack of faith brings about a sense of helplessness and despair, and also, you know, thoughts of suicide and whatnot. And again, I'm not saying that a Muslim cannot go down despair. Of course, that is possible. But generally speaking, the general rule is strong iman helps us in this regard. Also, another point is that when we believe in heaven and hell, then it helps us overcome difficult times, and it helps us to be optimistic even in the most, you know, awkward or the most, you know, problematic of circumstances. We look forward to something better in the future. Life is very difficult for some people, much worse than others. And, you know, it's very difficult to contextualize, to understand, especially when you look at the evil happening. And again, this is one of the common reasons why atheists reject God, and they say, why would a God, you know, send a tsunami wave, or these innocent children are starving, or this and that is happening? And if you do not believe in a heaven and hell, there is no answer you can give. But once you bring heaven and hell into the equation, it is very easy to say, you know, the pain of 5 minutes, the pain of a few years is nothing compared to the bliss of the eternity. That you are going to suffer just a little bit of time, however long that is. And if you are faithful and pious and righteous, so that child that died, you know, the parents, the child of course is going to Jannah. And the parents, when they are patient, will also be reunited with that child in Jannah. If you take away the concept of heaven and hell, you have no mechanism of explaining the pain and suffering in this world. And you will then lead down your road of more helplessness and more denial of God. A belief in the afterlife and a belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a logical corollary. The two go hand in hand. If you believe in Allah, and we must believe in Allah because that explains our existence, you will automatically believe in a heaven and a hell, and in Jannah, and in a Qiyamah as well. And also, one of the reasons we believe in heaven and hell is a sense of justice, a sense of reckoning. It helps us calm down, to placate the anger, the rage of all of the injustice in the world. Because indeed, there's a lot of injustice in the world. And a lot of times it seems that the criminals get away. Those who rob, those who steal. And I mean here not just those who rob you at gunpoint. Sometimes it is the dictator. Sometimes it is our own elected politicians. Sometimes it is corrupt CEOs. They seem to get away with stealing the money of innocent people. And by stealing, I don't mean necessarily putting a gun. I mean what is going on in the world. The rich and the powerful get more and more rich and powerful, and they're feeding off of the poor and the helpless. Where is the ultimate sense of justice here? And that is why when you believe in heaven and hell, you automatically have a sense of consolation that that person who murdered, you know, so many people, you know, when I'm giving this lecture series right now, we are seeing, of course, some of you will see this many years from now, but right now, alive, when we're seeing this, is that the trial is taking place of the mass murder in New Zealand who massacred over 50 Muslims. And we are seeing, you know, daily what the video footage, subhanAllah, of the survivors and the family members, powerful footage. And this vile creature that committed this atrocious crime on innocent women and children that were praying, 50 plus people were killed. He's going to live his life in an air-conditioned room, being provided solid, you know, food, good meals three times a day, you know, entertainment and television. Yes, he's in jail, but do you think that is what he should deserve? That just to be, you know, living his life comfortably until he dies and being provided entertainment and food and meals and books and whatnot? And okay, even if he's in jail, where is the justice? Who's gonna account for all of that? And how about the dictators that are killing their own people? How about, you know, the people who are killing innocents around the world? If you don't believe in hell, then what is the sense of who's gonna? And also the opposite. There are so many people, they have done good, and yet they die in a way that might not be the most, they're not rewarded in this world. They're not rewarded for their good. So when you believe in heaven and hell, it changes the entire paradigm. There's a sense of accountability. There's a sense of optimism. There's a sense of hope. We also overcome that in case we don't get what we want, in case there's a loss or something, we know that we can make it up in the next life. And therefore, we say that believing in Jannah and Nar, it is one of the most important pillars, not just of Iman, but to be honest, of living a sane and an optimistic life. And that is why it is so important, dear Muslim, that we spend time literally contemplating heaven and hell. That is why the Quran mentions heaven and hell so frequently, because it's not just abstract beliefs. It is a belief that will translate into a lived reality of how you're going to go about your daily routine, of how you're going to cope with troubles, with success, with injustice, of how you're going to deal with all the negativity of the world. Belief in heaven and hell allows you to live a sane life in this world. It's very simple. And that is why these fundamentals are so important for us, because without them, subhanAllah, life becomes very difficult. And I have to say on a personal note, I don't even understand how a person who doesn't believe in a higher power and doesn't believe in a God and doesn't believe in heaven and hell, I just don't understand what motivates them to even live, not just live a good life, to live even. It's a bleak, dismal world, and there's so many problems and issues. And if you think that you're going to end and you're just not going to be conscious anymore, well then what is the purpose of moving on? And that is why when you actually believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your iman, your heart feels so much at ease. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. I want to conclude on an interesting question, and then inshallah we'll continue and go into the actual details of how the Allah describes the Quran in the Quran and Sunnah, heaven and hell. I want to conclude by a very important facet, and that is that these days it's not just a simple reality of describing heaven and hell. We are facing an onslaught of atheists and of those who reject all faiths, that they are mocking our religion, all religions, not just our religion. And just like the Arabs of old mocked the Jahili Arabs, they mocked the Quran, the Quraysh mocked the heaven and hell and the concept of resurrection. They said, how is it possible? So too, exactly the same mentality, even though the words are different, are the modern protagonists of atheism, where they belittle our faith, they mock the sensual pleasures of heaven and the eternal, you know, punishments of Jahannam. And sometimes even our youth and our Muslim brothers and sisters are like, why is heaven described with such sensual pleasures? And why is hell described with such brutal, you know, vivid graphic details of punishment? And again, we're going to go back to this question over and over again, but this is our first lecture. So to set the stage here, first and foremost, it's not just about the punishments of the body or the pleasures of the body. Not at all. It's true, it's there. There's no denying that. But much more important than the physical punishment or the physical pleasures is the attainment of Allah's pleasure and the abstaining Allah's pleasure is Allah's rida, and to save ourselves from Allah's anger and humiliation. And that is why in the Quran, the two are linked together. For example, the concept of wala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that wala tukhzini yawma yub'athun, that Allah says in the Quran, that one of the du'as that we make, wala tukhzina yawma al-qiyamah, don't humiliate us, O Allah, on the day of judgment, that whoever earns the displeasure of Allah has been humiliated. And in the hadith, in the people of Jannah, when they ask Allah Azza wa Jal, and they ask and they ask, Allah says, I have something even more than what you can possibly ask for. And they say, oh Allah, what could possibly be more than Jannah? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I will now give you my pleasure, and I'll never be angry at you. So the pleasure of Allah and the attainment of the happiness of our Creator, it is a more important goal than the pleasures of the body. And the same goes to abstain from the wrath of Allah, the anger of Allah, to abstain from the humiliation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A'udhu billah, we seek Allah's refuge. There is no humiliation greater than the humiliation of your Creator, that turning away from you and not giving you His mercy. So that is what we want to avoid. Therefore, the punishments of hell and the blessings of Jannah, they are there, they are real, but they are not the ultimate. The ultimate goal, in the end of the day, hell and heaven are created, and Jannah is a manifestation of Allah's mercy. We want Allah's mercy, and when we get it, we get Jannah. And hell is a manifestation of Allah's anger. We don't want Allah's anger. When we are saved from Allah's anger, we are saved from hell. So realize, the goal is not Jannah directly. It's an indirect goal, no question about that. We are not watering anything down. We want Jannah. We ask Allah for Jannah. But the ultimate goal is the pleasure of Allah. And along with the pleasure of Allah, one of the perks of the pleasures of Allah is Jannah. And the same goes for Jahannam, that the actual goal is the avoidance of Allah's anger, of Allah's wrath, of Allah's humiliation. That's the first point. The second point is that these people who make fun of the pleasures of Jannah or the pain of Jahannam and whatnot, you know, it belies human reality. No society can function without checks and balances, without perks, without, you know, the carrot and the stick, as the saying goes. No corporation can flourish without rewarding those that are loyal and good, and then, you know, dealing with those that are not and not doing their good job. This is the reality of our existence. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is simply talking to us in the language that we all understand. We desire some good. We don't want to have any physical pain or punishment. Their notion, those atheists, of living a good life for the sake of goodness. SubhanAllah, since when does any society ever function of this? It sounds all nice and philosophical and platonic and whatnot, but that is not lived reality. And this leads me to my third point. These very people that make fun of Jannah, these atheists, they make fun of Jannah, and they make fun of the wine of Jannah and the women of Jannah and the pleasures of Jannah. Ask them, what do you do in this world for pleasure? How do you attain pleasure in this world? You make fun. You would think then if you make fun of that you should live ascetic lives. You should go live in the caves, not have any good food, not have any intimacy, not have anything. It is as if they want to get the pleasures of Jannah in a haram manner in this world. And as for us, we say, if we live pure, righteous lives, then Allah will bless us in a halal way, what we were deprived of in a haram way in this world. So we find the hypocrisy of the very people that make fun of these concepts, that in reality, they are the most hedonistic and the most sensualistic of all people, and the irony and the hypocrisy of them daring to make fun of the Akhirah, even as they demonstrate in this world what human nature is in a manner that is the most vile and the most vulgar. So please spare me your pontifications and stop preaching to me this version of an afterlife morality that you yourselves cannot live up to in this world. We have to point this out as well. And then the final point that we'll say as well is that there is a level of arrogance that is associated with those people who mock an afterlife, just like the arrogance of the Quraysh as well. That level of arrogance presupposes that they are more knowledgeable and more powerful than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, those people who reject the Akhirah, who reject the notions of a heaven and hell today, we can use the same verses that came down for the Quraysh upon these modern protagonists of atheism. And we say to them that who knows better, Allah or you? We say to them, isn't the one who created the creation capable of creating a heaven and hell? Isn't the one who made us in this manner and made the world with such perfection capable of creating alternatives? And that's really the whole point here. And this is why we believe in Iman bil Ghaib. It is a package deal. It is a package deal. Once you believe in Allah, and you must believe in Allah, then automatically everything else fits into place. The God who created you and created the world around you has the power and the wisdom to create alternative universes, and those are the universes of the Akhirah, which we don't understand fully, and yet we can understand the power of the one who can do that. We can appreciate Allah's Qudra and Allah's knowledge, and we appreciate Allah's hikmah in that regard. And so we say to them, just like the Quraysh of old were told as well, that how can you deny the one that created you the first time can definitely do this all over again. So this was our brief introduction to multiple concepts. And then inshallah ta'ala, in our next lesson, we will start the detailed descriptions of what we know of the realities of Jannah and Jahannam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be of the inhabitants of Jannah, and we seek His refuge from ever being of the inhabitants of Jahannam. Until next time, Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ya man ajabat du'a Nuhin fantasar wa hamaltahu fi fulkika al-mashhun. Ya man ahala an-nar hawla khalilihi rawhan wa rayhanan.